next on Unsolved Mysteries. Tijuana, Mexico. Party time turns lethal when a college student is found dead on a street. A college athlete sprints from his bed through the frigid winter night while he's asleep. 60 years ago, an Army spy disappeared. A mysterious phone call may hold the key. A family's dream house is a living nightmare until a team of Ghostbusters arrives. Five cases, some without endings. Our team is working on them, and perhaps you can help. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Tijuana, one of Mexico's most popular border towns for college students hunting for big fun at bargain rates. But a good time here can cost you your life. 1:30 a.m. Stephen Thomas is looking for his brother Jason in the crowds of partiers. They become separated while heading back to their car.
I look to the right of me. I turned around, my brother wasn't there. I mean, it was like that.
An hour and a half after Jason disappears, a Tijuana police officer discovers his battered body in the road.
Jason was drinking, and he was loud and obnoxious and maybe out of control. That night, I believe that Jason was murdered by the Tijuana police.
20-year-old Jason Artis was attending college in Los Angeles. He brought his younger brother, Stephen, out for a visit and a good time south of the border. But that good time would end in tragedy. Saturday night, the main drag was packed. For many, the loose drinking laws here were the biggest attraction. About 9 p.m., Jason, Steve, and their friend Michael Justin started bar hopping, hitting places that offered all you could drink for less than $5. Jason was usually friendly, but he had a reputation as a rowdy drinker. That night, he was already a little buzzed, and he didn't realize that tequila cost extra, $6 a shot.
Now you owe me
$12.
$12? You crazy, man!
Jason didn't want to give up the money, so I just said, Jason, give him the money. Just give him the money and let's get out of here. You know what I'm saying? This ain't the spot we need to be at.
Man, I'll meet you in the car in 15 minutes.
Jason and Steven left Michael at the bar and went back to the strip.
My strategy was to hurry up and find the car so we can go sit down. We're kind of drunk, you know what I'm saying? Walking around Tijuana.
Please, man.
We were walking down the street, and that's when my brother accidentally bumped into a female officer.
Just hit me.
Well, I was kind of frustrated at my brother for the simple fact of being that drunk. My feelings was just, I'm ready to go home. I'm ready to get back to Van Nuys.
Look, Jason, man, you acting crazy, man. This ain't our country. You almost just got
I told him, walk behind me. Come on, let's hurry up and try to find this car. He's like 3 or 4 yards behind me at first. That's when I walked up some more to another block. So we walked up. I looked to the right, and I looked behind me, and my brother wasn't there. My first reaction was probably that he's sitting down on a curb somewhere or sitting up against a building or anything like that, you know what I'm saying? Because we were kind of intoxicated.
Soon after Stephen lost sight of Jason, Michael claims that he spotted him in the back of a police car.
I looked and I said, what is he doing in the back of a police car?
They were the last people I saw Jason with. I saw Jason with my own eyes in the back of a police car, like I know my hand.
Michael and Steven never saw Jason again. Jason's family was shocked when 2 days later, the American consulate sent word that he was dead. His aunt, Tina Martin Smith, went to Tijuana to identify the body.
I remember thinking, this is not Jason there. Jason is somewhere in a jail in Tijuana, and someone has robbed him, and they've taken his ID, and this person is in the morgue. And I looked down, and it was Jason. It was Jason.
Tijuana authorities told Jason's family that he must have gotten lost trying to get back to the border. They called it a tragic hit-and-run accident. But Steven doubts that story.
I believe that it had something to do with the police. I feel that for a fact. After Michael told me that he seen my brother in the back of a police car, there's gotta be something up there.
Tijuana police deny the allegation. They claim they never even had Jason in custody.
We check and double check almost the whole month of August, and there is no detention with that name. Sometimes it happens that they miswrite the name in our computer, so we run it with the three names. We found nothing.
Jason's family obtained a copy of the autopsy report through the American consulate and had it translated into English.
Nothing was adding up. First of all, they stated that Jason was hit by a car, and we had these conflicting things. We had the photos of him with no injuries to his lower extremities, with these unexplained 5-inch marks all over his body and chest area and in his face.
We asked three forensic pathologists to review the report. One agreed with the hit-and-run finding. The other two, however, questioned the official results.
I would be very skeptical of, one, the autopsy findings and the assertion that this was simply a hit-and-run accident. One has to apply a high degree of skepticism to the entire autopsy, in my view.
For instance, the Tijuana coroner claimed the car hit Jason so hard in the chest that it ruptured his heart.
In order for a blunt blow to get through the sternum and rupture the heart, it would have to virtually crush the chest. And it's quite evident from the autopsy that chest is not badly mashed. There are no bruises on it. There are no big hematomas. So that becomes incredible. The autopsy report becomes incredible.
Another point. Jason's head wounds were similar to those caused by a beating.
Certainly, the lesions around the head and the skull, which was severe, are certainly consistent with the butt of a rifle or any other sharp or even blunt object that could be used on an individual.
I believe that he was beaten. And after he was beaten, perhaps in an attempt to destroy the evidence, that they perhaps ran over and or drug him. And I believe that when he was run over, that he was already dead.
Tijuana authorities have closed the case. They believe Jason's family may be overreacting.
We have had responses from the families in conflict with the saying of the autopsy and the statement from our department. Where there are witnesses of an accident and there is a driver responsible for the accident, there have been some families stating that they are not accepting that it was an accident.
Maybe he should have gone to jail for the night, but he didn't. Nobody deserves to die that way.
Jason's family hopes that anyone with information about his death will log on to our website at unsolved.com. Coming up, mysterious cases of sleepwalking that result in injury and even death. The mysterious world of sleepwalking. It's often portrayed as harmless or even amusing, but in reality, it can be dangerous and sometimes deadly. Iowa City, Iowa. Jared Allgood was a talented football player during his waking hours, but was a habitual sleepwalker at night. It all began when he was a young boy.
He was a major sleepwalker, and all of my boys are. And that scared me, and I talk about it, and I'd ask the doctors about it. And they would just pretty much poo-poo it, like it's really nothing, because I had asked.
When Jared went to college, his sleepwalking continued. Nothing serious happened until one early winter morning. Jared was up, his eyes wide open, but he was not awake. He ran more than a mile barefoot on the icy pavement. Witnesses later reported that he sprinted with the intensity of a runner at the finish line.
People who have these episodes spontaneously, like Jared, get stuck in this state between wakefulness and sleep. Awake enough to perform complex behaviors, not awake enough to be aware of what we're doing or responsible for what we're doing.
Somehow, in his sleep, Jared managed to exit his apartment, weave around parked cars, and turn corners as he ran. Then, in mid-stride, tragedy. Jared Allgood died instantly. Initially, authorities speculated that he committed suicide. Jared's mother didn't buy it. She talked to her son's roommate and learned that Jared was having a reoccurring dream about running in a race.
Jared said, it's a crazy dream. I'm running a race with a man from Bertram, only the man is in a car and I'm on foot running a race as hard as I can run.
Some may dismiss this as just a coincidence, but Jared was killed as he was running down a road that leads to the town of Bertram. Becky Allgood was absolutely convinced that her son had not taken his own life, and experts agreed.
There was not one shred of evidence that he had depression or any other reason to commit suicide. There was no evidence of drugs or alcohol involved. The only reasonable explanation is that this was yet just another one of his sleepwalking episodes.
In the end, authorities agreed. Jared Allgood became the first person in Iowa history whose death was attributed to sleepwalking.
When I hear stories about Jared Allgood, I think that possibly could have been me. And that scares me to think that.
Like Jared, Heidi Ruiz is a dedicated athlete and a sleepwalker. She was attending college on a track and field scholarship and felt a tremendous pressure to perform.
I wasn't running from a particular person or a thing. I was just running because I felt like it was the end of the world. It was like a monster inside me trying to get out. I heard a blood-curdling scream.
Heidi's mother witnessed two of the most violent episodes.
Bang, two big hits where I could hear her coming through doors. I have to tell you, the force of her running through that hall, I will never forget, because of the terror, the looking of terror on her face was so incredible. And for a mom to not know what to do in order for her not to be able to hurt herself again was a real scary thing, real scary.
The biggest episode was in my mom's house back in August of 95. Must have gotten out of bed and took one step and bolted straight into the wall.
The impact tore open Heidi's forehead. She gashed her wrist as she fell to the floor.
Calm down, honey.
I decided I couldn't handle it anymore. I was terrified, and I said, I need to go seek help.
Heidi was tested at the world-renowned sleep clinic in Northern California.
I had electrodes all over my head. I had a pulse on my finger. I mean, I was hooked up. Like, I felt like I was from Mars. It was very, very uncomfortable, but it was an extensive test, and they had to see what was going on.
Through a testing process here in a moment or so.
We wanted to see if we might be able to capture a sleepwalking episode, but that can be rare because it might not occur every night. But secondly, we also wanted to rule out the possibility that it wasn't something else, such as seizure activity, a sleep-related breathing disorder, or even leg movements that were causing the person to awaken and triggering off an attack.
Dr. Kushida could find no physiological causes for Heidi's sleepwalking, but he was able to pinpoint what is likely to trigger an episode.
There's a lot of different triggers. One of them is sleep deprivation. Secondly, stress can also increase the chance that the person might have sleepwalking.
Both Heidi Ruiz and Jared Allgood fit that pattern. Their sleepwalking flared up under heavy emotional pressure and lack of sleep. Heidi now has her sleepwalking condition under control through medication and careful stress management.
Unfortunately, a lot of sleep is still a mystery, a big mystery in terms of a lot of the causes of these sleep disorders, but you know, it's something that we're all trying to really work hard on.
The world of sleep and dreams has been the subject of extensive research. But after decades of testing, scientists are still left with more questions than answers. If you or someone you know is suffering from a serious sleep disorder, it should not be ignored. Please consult a doctor. Next, a missing persons investigator searches for her own father, who disappeared more than 60 years ago. September of 1945, World War II is over. The heroes are finally coming home. Arlington, Virginia. Lieutenant Ray Hickingbotham settled down with his wife, Dorothy, and three-year-old daughter, Carol. A decorated war hero, Ray was assigned to Army Intelligence.
My memory was one of a kind of magical summer. It was the first time I had a dad at home and my mom there. There was just a lot of fun, a lot of time for the family to be together.
I gotcha.
The base housed a top-secret radio operation. Ray may have been part of a select group of expert codebreakers. His assignment, monitoring radio communications from behind the Iron Curtain. The Cold War had begun.
It's a good ulcer job. You're sitting at a desk, you're not mobile, you can't get up. I've seen them scream sometimes, and just physical frustration, and it's just trying to ventilate their frustration while they continue plodding away with this boring but potentially incredibly fascinating job.
I think I've got something.
In less than a year, Ray and his group would be absorbed into the newly created Central Intelligence Agency. Ray was working long hours and spending little time with his family.
Be back, pick me up at 3.
In the summer of 1947, Ray was transferred to another top secret group. He did not tell Dorothy about the new assignment.
My mother was worried because he seemed so tired and so uptight. He became very tense, and it became worse. It just got worse and worse.
Late that summer, Dorothy took Carol to Long Island for a two-week visit with her grandparents. When Dorothy tried to phone Ray, she was given the surprising news that he had gone on leave. Then she learned that the military had, without explanation, hired a moving crew to clean out their apartment. 2 weeks later, a moving van showed up at Dorothy's parents' home. In the boxes and trunks, there was not one single item belonging to Ray.
No pictures, no letters, no writing, nothing. It was as though he had been purged from our lives, as though he was completely gone and wiped out. And my mother just didn't know what to make of it.
A month went by, and then a man claiming to be from the Army visited Dorothy with shocking news.
Look, this is all I know. On October 14th, 1947, he was listed as AWOL. 30 days later, he was dropped from the military rolls and classified as a deserter.
As a result, Dorothy and Carol lost all of their military benefits. Dorothy later tried to get in touch with the mysterious visitor. The Army said they had never heard of him.
My mother was alone. She was frightened. And she was afraid something terrible had happened to my father. Perhaps he'd gone overseas and been killed in the line of duty. She could not comprehend that he would just disappear. She really thought the government was withholding information from her.
It is absolutely not total paranoia to wonder if the CIA or another intelligence branch had something to do with his disappearance. I can think of a half dozen cases where people, you know, there were weird things like that happened, where the family was not told the truth and the loved one did disappear or died and they weren't told how they died.
Ray was labeled a deserter and was disgraced. Carol and her mother struggled to make ends meet. Carol grew up, married, and moved to Oklahoma. She became a private investigator specializing in reuniting families. But she never gave up the search for her own father.
As I looked through the material that I received, I began to get a picture of someone very special, someone very highly trained, someone who had performed at the top level, and I came to believe that this was a man who would not just disappear.
After years of butting heads with government bureaucracy, Carol finally went to the media. An article about her missing father appeared in the local Arlington newspaper. 3 hours later, she received a phone call.
Hello?
The caller identified himself by a code name,
this is
Archangel.
She.
He was using a mobile
this
phone and would not reveal his exact location.
He said that my article had really rattled cages at the CIA and that it had really shook people up. Those were his words.
Now listen carefully. I've got to give you some background. There had been sensitive leaks in the atomic energy area, and your dad was investigating those leaks. In August of 47, an attempt was made on his life. His superior decided to bury your father. It was easier to drop out 20 years ago. Things were different.
The man told Carol that her father was not a deserter. Ray's life had been in danger, so a paper trail was created to cover his disappearance.
The whole time he was a few miles from Arlington.
Archangel revealed the astonishing news that for nearly a year, Ray had lived only 3 miles away from Carol and her mother. He had been hidden by the government in the suburbs of Washington, D.C.
Where is he now?
Your father is still alive.
His name is Nelson. He lives in a NATO country where there are high mountains,
crystal clear lakes, and a long time democracy. That's all I can say.
When I hung up the phone, I felt very drained. Maybe he was a jokester or a con artist. Maybe he was going to call back and want money. I just didn't know what to believe. But there was a part of me that kept saying, my dad's alive. There's a chance.
Carol never heard from the mysterious caller again. But she and her son, Ian, have never stopped trying to decipher Archangel's clues.
It's crystal clear lakes.
It is possible that my father chose to follow his career and that that was what he wanted above all else, including myself and our family. And that's very painful. I have compassion for a young man who may have made a wrong choice. We all make wrong choices. And I want my father to know that we love him and that it's It's forgotten. We just want the pain of not having him to end.
Carol hopes to someday reunite with her father, or at least clear him of the charge that he's a deserter. If you have any information about this case, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, the incredible story of a supernatural force that is terrorizing an entire family. Mommy! For most of us, haunted houses are the places we visit on Halloween. We scream, we jump, we laugh, and then we go home. But in Ohio, a family has to deal with the horrifying fact that for them, home is a haunted house. A newly married couple, we'll call them Joe and Mary Smith, thought they were moving into their dream home. But when Mary was pregnant with their first child, they got a warning that something was wrong.
It really worried me because it sounded much more than a mouse or a raccoon or something. Sort of like grating noises and things being dragged, so to speak.
Mary called her father, a police detective. He approached the attic expecting a burglar.
Sweetheart, take a look at this.
The attic was a disaster zone. Blankets pulled out, boxes of Christmas ornaments dumped, childhood trinkets broken. Yet there was no sign of an intruder. The attic had been sealed tight.
At that point, I just shivered, kind of like with fear, because something was there that I didn't know about, and I didn't particularly care for that feeling at all.
Doorknobs turned on their own, and the strange noises continued. Mary soon learned that the house had a disturbing past. The previous owners had reportedly adopted a little boy. One day, he just mysteriously vanished, and to this day, no one knows what happened to him. Mary suspected that that boy might be linked to the hauntings. One night, when her own son was almost the same age as the missing child, Mary says that he let out a blood-curdling scream.
It just was a very tormented type of a cry. That's what I heard in his voice, was that horrible fear.
What do you see, honey?
Mary had no idea what upset her son until he happened to visit his grandmother a few weeks later.
And he says, Grandma, I want to go home. I'm not never coming back here again. I says, why? Why aren't you coming back? He says, no, devil. And I thought, what is he talking about?
What?
A devil.
What are you saying?
A devil.
Devil?
The child was pointing at a religious painting of St. Michael the Archangel trampling Satan underfoot. The little boy later told his mother it was the same devil he had seen in his bedroom. Mary and her husband considered moving many times, but they had too much invested in the house. Finally, Mary discovered what she now believes is the key to the disturbing events.
Now we've had a nice walk. No. We hold hands till we get back.
The little boy who once lived there had apparently died under mysterious circumstances.
In the kitchen.
And he was buried somewhere on the property.
It just was creepy. I perhaps thought there might be a connection. In fact, it wasn't a might be. I was very concerned that there probably was a connection.
When most people think of a haunted house, they think of spirits of the dead. But in most cases, houses that are haunted genuinely appear to be haunted by some type of an energy force.
At our request, Dr. Nichols and two colleagues investigated Mary's home.
We conducted a series of energy field scans throughout the house to try to establish a baseline energy field reading, electromagnetic, electric, magnetic fields, microwave fields, to try to determine if there are any unusual energy fields present in the house.
In one of the bedrooms, they found a strong electromagnetic field that surrounded a dresser left behind by previous owners.
One of the suggestions that I made to the family was that they remove the dresser at least from the bedroom and preferably from the house temporarily and see if it has an effect on the haunting phenomena that they're experiencing.
The parapsychologists found even stronger readings in the basement, where an abandoned well ran deep down to an underground lake.
We find many houses that are haunted are located over sources of underground water. And so there does seem to be a correlation. This may conduct some form of psychic energy. It may conduct some form of natural earth-based magnetic fields that stimulates a person's psychic abilities. People ask us frequently, do we believe in ghosts? And the answer is yes. There's no question that people experience ghosts. But what are they? Are they actually spirits of the dead? Are they some type of entities from another dimension? Or are they some strange artifact of the human psyche? Unfortunately, those are questions which, for now, remain an unsolved mystery.
Next, a young boy whose mother was murdered is the key to catching her killer. It was a summer day in Vancouver, Washington.
Let me zip your coat up. You gonna have fun with Daddy this weekend? Mm-hmm.
Five-year-old Dustin Johnson was waiting for his father to pick him up for a custody visit. Dustin didn't know it, but he was saying goodbye to his mother for the last time.
Give me a kiss. I love you.
I love you.
Here's your bag.
Remember my mom getting me ready to go with my dad? She gave me a hug and a kiss goodbye and told me she'd see me when I come back. But then I come back and Mom wasn't there.
That same weekend, Patricia Johnson was murdered. 9 days later, her naked, decomposing body was found. 2 weeks later, Patricia's own brother, Dennis Keith Smith, confessed to the crime. He was sentenced to life in prison on a charge of second-degree murder. Dustin moved in with his mother's parents. When Dennis Smith was paroled 10 years later, he came to live in the same house. Every day, Dustin Johnson had to face the man who killed his mother. And then another local woman mysteriously disappeared. Dustin became convinced that his uncle was somehow involved.
Your lunch is made.
Thanks, honey.
Dan and Carolyn Killaby lived just 3 miles from Dustin. They were planning an evening out.
We don't have the kids tonight, so why don't we just get together and have dinner, spend some time together?
Okay. All right.
It promised to be a romantic evening, just the two of them. But before Dan left work, his brother called and invited him to stop by.
We ended up going down to a tavern down the street, and we had a beer, and we started shooting some pool. Turned out there was a Blazer game on. We started watching that. We had a couple more beers. And I had decided just to stay behind at his place and chose not to drive home.
Dan didn't call home until 1 a.m.
Hi, Carolyn. It's me. Listen, I'm going to stay at Dave's tonight. I had a few beers, so, you know, I better just stay here. I will see you in the morning.
Oh. Sunday morning, Dan returned to an empty house. His message was still on the machine.
Carolyn!
He assumed that Carolyn was angry with him for not showing up. But by Sunday night, he began to worry.
Hello, Susan. Yeah, this is Dan.
Dan called everyone in his wife's phone book from A to Z. No one could account for Carolyn. Carolyn still hadn't showed up by 6 a.m. Monday when she was due at work. Dan and his brother cruised the streets of Vancouver looking for any sign of Carolyn. Finally, they found her car in a nightclub parking lot.
This is her car.
The morning barmaid was the gal that worked there Saturday night. And she said, yeah, I saw your wife. She was in Saturday night. That's the last time I saw her. So at that point, you know, panic set in. The car was there. My wife was nowhere to be found.
When Dustin Johnson read about Carolyn Killaby in the local newspaper, one fact jumped out.
I found a name by the name of Dennis in the newspaper, and I continued to read that the lady was missing, and I had this feeling that that person by the name of Dennis might be my uncle. This might be a weird conversation.
Dustin found Dan Killaby's number and called him.
Yeah?
I just was reading through there and found the name of Dennis. Do you know what Dennis's last name is?
He called me and said he'd saw the article, and if this Dennis that was mentioned in the article was in fact Dennis Keith Smith, that was his uncle. And he wanted to let me know that he had murdered his mother.
Authorities had not yet released the last name of the man seen with Carolyn. Dan asked detectives to check out Dustin's hunch.
But he said that he thinks that the man Dennis that you're looking for, his name is Dennis Smith, and he said that this guy is a murderer. Is that true?
There was a long pause from the detectives, and I knew right then it was the person. At that point in time, I think right then and there, I knew my wife had been killed. Right there.
The nightclub bartender helped police reconstruct what probably happened to Carolyn Killaby.
You can tell it on her face, she's been crying. She was alone. She didn't want to be with anybody. She's upset. If she would have had one more drink, she would have been passed out, probably going to the hospital. She's really bad off.
She's trouble.
Her?
Oh, yeah.
Dennis Smith was a regular at the club. According to the bartender, Smith had been watching Carolyn all night long. At about 11:30, he made his move.
It's just the way he walked up to her is as if they're old friends. But she didn't know who she was with. He spoke to her for a few seconds. She lifted her head up. He had one arm around his neck and had a hold of it and walked out with her.
Detectives decided that it was time to have a little talk with Dennis Smith.
Who was it you talked to?
It was the bouncer.
Okay, you said the waitress or bartender?
Yeah, which is it? Probably isn't both of them at this point, right?
So he would laugh at times for no real apparent reason, which is very indicative of someone that's trying to be deceitful.
You were in your truck for 45 minutes.
Yeah. What happened?
Come on.
Come on, Dennis, we're all adults. What's going on? What happens?
She attacked me, so, you know, I'm winded and I'm pretty tired after that. And we, you know,
look at you attack.
And then I see this guy and he's got like the stick in his hand.
Smith went on to claim that the stranger threatened him and then took Carolyn away.
It was a stick. What are you talking about?
Detectives had a hard time believing that story. Especially when they inspected Smith's pickup truck.
Oh man, that's more than a cigarette burn. Yeah, it looks like he took a torch to it.
It wasn't just the gaping hole in the seat that aroused suspicion. The seat cover had been removed and every inch of carpeting had been stripped off the floor.
And at that point, basically, I knew that Dennis was hiding something from us. Maybe any evidence that Carolyn was in his truck or that something bad happened to her in the truck.
But there was no proof that Carolyn was actually dead, and suspicions alone weren't enough to keep Dennis Smith in custody. By the time police collected enough evidence, Smith left town. A warrant was put out for his arrest. Update. On the night of our broadcast, Tracy Hodelman and John Cummings were watching the program with their new neighbor, Dave Sanborn.
He kind of started getting nervous, and they started describing the color of his tattoos that were on his arm. And I looked over and I said, "You have those color tattoos, you know?" And he asked me, "Is there anything else on?" He didn't want to watch the show. And I said, "No, I like the show, I'll watch it." And he, you know, got up and went in the kitchen and he started pacing around.
Dave Sanborn, of course, turned out to be Dennis Keith Smith. He stole his neighbor's car, but police caught up with Smith 2 days later at this intersection.
He turned and charged the officers and a fight ensued. During the course of that fight, he attempted to remove the firearm from one of the officers, was beginning to successfully remove that firearm when the second officer fired a single shot, striking Mr. Smith in the neck.
Smith was also shot in the wrist during the struggle. After 2 weeks in a hospital, he recovered enough to appear in a Florida courtroom. Smith was extradited to Washington and tried on a charge of first-degree murder. He was found guilty and sentenced to 70 years behind bars. He also received an additional 99 years for violating parole. But the story of Dennis Keith Smith does not end here. While in prison, Smith hanged himself with a bedsheet attached to an air vent. He was 42 years old.